Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse number 11. Enjoy the service tonight. Just sing the Spirit of the Lord. I'm just thankful to be with you again tonight. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse number 11. You found your place, say amen.
Amen.
For this commandment which I command thee this day, it is not hidden from thee, neither is it far off. It is not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who shall go up for us to heaven, and bring it unto us that we may hear it and do it. Neither is it beyond the sea that thou shouldest say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us that we may hear it and do it? But the word is very nigh unto thee, even or in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it. See, I have set before thee this day life and good, death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply, and the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. But if thine heart turn away, so that thou wilt not hear, but shalt be drawn away, and worship other gods, and serve them, I denounce unto you this day that ye shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land whither thou passest over Jordan to go to possess it. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live, that thou mayest love the Lord thy God, that thou mayest obey his voice, and that thou mayest cleave unto him. For he is thy life, amen, and the length of thy days, that thou mayest dwell in the land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and if you would once again pray for me, that the Lord would touch me as I try to preach the message this evening. Our Father in heaven, as we bow before you in the precious name of Jesus, Lord, once again, we want to thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. And Lord, I want to thank you for the people of God who have laid aside the cares of this world, the cares of this life, to be in the Lord's house. Lord, I pray that you bless them, Lord. And God, I pray that you use me, Lord, to speak to your people this evening. Lord, I pray that we would leave this place saying it's been good to be in the Lord's house. Lord, I pray we would leave this place different than when we came. Lord, I pray that you would empty me of myself, and God, that you fill me with your power. Lord, there's nothing within me, but Lord, I pray that you would take this thing tonight and take it far beyond us tonight. Lord, I pray, Lord, that we would leave here saying that surely the Lord has met with us tonight. And God, for what you do, we'll be careful to give you all the glory, all the praise, and all the honor. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Well, here in our text, Moses, the man of God, is reaching the end of his life. He's been wandering in the wilderness with a bunch of belly-aching, backslidden Hebrews for 40 long years. So here's Moses, and he calls together all of Israel and begins to speak unto them, thus saith the Lord. He speaks unto the congregation of Israel words of remembrance, words of admonition, words of instruction, words of caution, and last but not least, words of warning. So here's Moses, the man of God, speaking to this massive congregation of people. And the voice of the old man of God echoes over the crowd as he proclaims, "I call heaven and earth to record against you this day that I have set before you life and death and blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life that both thou and thy seed may live." So Moses, the man of God, presents the children of Israel with the choice that they must make. He said, "I set before you life and death, blessing and cursing." And he admonishes them to choose life. Ladies and gentlemen, God, our Creator, created all of us with a will. God did not create us to be robots with no mind or will of our own. But God created us as unique individuals with a volition and a self-will of our own. God is a gentleman. He will never force you to do His will. He may make you wish you had done His will. But He will never make you do His will. For instance, it is the will of God for every man, woman, boy, and girl to be saved by the grace of God. Amen. That is the will of God. Amen? But it doesn't make anyone get saved. If you decide to reject Christ and go to hell, then ultimately that is your choice to make. But the fact of the matter is, we make choices every day of our lives. We choose what we're going to wear. We choose what we're going to eat. We choose where we're going to go, where we're not going to go. We choose where we're going to attend church. And on the list could go. We're always making choices. But tonight we need to understand that the choices that we make carry side effects.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
That's right.
Now hear me out for just a few moments. I have made some good choices in my life.
Amen.
And I have enjoyed the blessings that come with those choices.
Amen.
It's sad to say I've made a few bad choices in my life, like we all have. And I've had to deal with the curses that came along with those choices. If the Lord will be gracious and help me for a few minutes tonight, I want to preach on the subject of the side effects of making choices. The side effects of making choices. Tonight I want us to look at a few choices in the Bible, both good and bad, and let's see what we can learn from them tonight. Number one, first of all, the first choice that I want to look at is a disastrous choice. A disastrous choice. And we're going to look at a man by the name of Lot. In Genesis chapter number 13, the flocks and the herds of Abraham and Lot had grown so much that the Bible says the land was no longer able to bear them. And the Bible says that there began to be strife between Abraham's herdsmen and Lot's herdsmen. Genesis 13 verses 8 and 9. And Abram said unto Lot, "Let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we be brethren. Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take the left hand, then I will go to the right. Or if thou depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left." So Lot goes to part ways with his godly uncle, Abraham. And the Bible says that Lot looked towards Sodom and saw the well-watered plains of Jordan. The Bible tells us that before God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah with fire and brimstone, that it was actually a beautiful place to behold. As a matter of fact, it said that it looked like the garden of the Lord. And Sodom was an attractive place to behold. And Lot got his eyes off of God. All he could see was the beauty. All he could see was the well-watered plains. And ladies and gentlemen, he became blind to the fact that he was about to become a compromiser. He became blind to sort of the downward spiral that his life was about to take and the destruction that awaited his family. Amen. Oh, listen to me tonight. tonight, before you begin to part ways with godly influence in your life, you better pause and take a good, long look at your family. Lot should have never parted ways with his godly uncle, but he took his eyes off God and got him on the well-watered plains of this world. Oh, listen to me this evening. In my 30 years of being in church, I've seen multitudes and multitudes of people who were in good, solid, Bible-preaching churches just like this one. And I've seen them cast their eyes towards Sodom. I've seen them start looking the ways of the world. And they parted ways with the house of God. And they parted ways with the man of God. And they parted ways with the people of God. And they parted ways with the word of God. And they pitched their tent towards Sodom. And my friend, they're joined up with the liberal church down the road, where everything goes and nobody preaches against sin. And my friend, not long, not far down the road, their lives end up wrecked and ruined, and their families have been busted up, and they could have saved themselves a world of heartache had they just stayed with the house of God. Amen. They'd have saved themselves a lot of heartbreak if they'd never made the disastrous choice of going to the world. Lot got his eyes on the well-watered plains of Jordan, and he made a disastrous choice. Lot started looking towards Sodom. The next thing you know, he's leaning towards Sodom. Before you know it, he's living in Sodom. And before it's all said and done, he loses everything he's got in Sodom.
Right.
Amen. Everything that God had blessed him with under the influence of his godly uncle, he lost every bit of it over a disastrous choice. So let's learn from that disastrous choice this evening. Number two, I see a deliberate choice in the Bible. A deliberate choice. We're going to look at a man by the name of Moses. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 24 and 25, Moses made a deliberate choice to serve God. And you know, you'll never serve God by accident.
Amen.
You're going to have to make a deliberate choice and serve the Lord on purpose. Amen. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 24 and 25, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. And here's our word: choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Now listen, Moses grew up in the palaces of this world. He was the adopted son of Pharaoh's daughter. He had all the pleasures of Egypt at his disposal. But when he came to years, he made a choice. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter anymore. He said, I'd rather suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. And my friend, he made a choice to put the world behind him and go forward and serve God. My friend, some of you need to make some decisions tonight when it comes to serving God. God give us some young people and older people tonight, my friend, that'll make a choice to say, I have decided to follow Jesus. Amen. The world behind me, the cross before me, though none go with me, still I will follow. I have decided to follow Jesus. God give us some people in these last days that'll make a deliberate choice to serve the Lord. Amen. God help us. Amen. Amen. I never been sorry that I gave Jesus the best years of my life. I've never been sorry, my friend, that day years ago when I made that deliberate choice to serve God. Amen. Amen. I can hear the Apostle Paul, and I know I've made reference to this the past three messages, but in Romans 12, 1 and 2, I can hear Paul as he says, I beseech you. That word beseech is a strong word.
Yeah.
Paul's pleading with them. He's begging them. He said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. My friend, there's a God in heaven that's saying it's high time that you put yourself on the altar and say along with the Apostle Paul in Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now
live in the flesh. I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I wonder if there's anybody in the house tonight that will say, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. He died for me. He gave his best for me. And tonight, because I love him, because he loves me, because he's a good God, because I want to serve him, because he's got my best interest in mind, without doubt, without fear, without reluctance, without hesitation, tonight I surrender all. Amen. God, help us to make that deliberate choice to serve God. Amen. Oh, listen to me, old and young alike. There's a God in heaven that's not looking for a part of you, or most of you, or a portion of you, but he's looking for all of you. And I wonder if there's a man, woman, boy, or girl in the church tonight that'll reach out and grab a hold of that truth and come to the place in their life where they say, you know what? Enough of the rut. Enough of the games. Enough of the routine. Enough of the holy decisions. Tonight, once and for all, whether the rest of the church does it or not, whether the rest of the youth department does it or not, I'm going to make a choice, a deliberate choice, to serve the Lord. Amen. Amen. You ever come to that place in your life? There's no telling what God wants to do with your life if you'll just surrender. Amen. No telling what God wants to do with your life. And I want to say there's absolutely nothing in this world that compares to serving God. Amen. Why don't you surrender and say, Jesus, I'm yours, lock, stock, and barrel. Lord, if you want me to be a missionary, Lord, that's what I'll be. Lord, if you want me to be a pastor, that's what I'll be. Lord, if you want me to scrub the toilets in the house of God, Lord, that's what I'll do. Lord, whatever you want me to do, God, just put me somewhere in the work of God. And my friend, I'm telling you, there's nothing more fulfilling. There's nothing more satisfied. There's nothing so rewarding as serving God. Amen. Amen. I want to ask you a question, young people. Did you know that God's got a plan for your life?
Amen.
You ever thought about that? Amen. God just didn't allow you to be born by accident. God knew who you were going to be and everything about you before you ever thought about. God knows everything about you. And God allowed you to be born and breathe his fresh air because he's got a task for you to do. Amen. Amen. God's got a purpose for you. You say, preacher, what is that purpose? I tell you what it is. Romans chapter 9, verse number 17. Romans chapter 9, verse 17. God said, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up. What is that purpose? That I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. That's God's purpose for your life tonight. Now, God's got different ways for us to do that. God's desire for your life may not be the exact same as mine, but my friend, God's got the same purpose for all of us, and that is that his name might be declared throughout all the earth and use our life to do it. God wants his power to be manifested in our life. My friend, God's got a plan. God's got a purpose. God created you with wonderful intentions in mind. God designed you with a specific reason, and oh, how disappointed. My friend, oh, how disappointed the Lord must be so many times when he looks down from heaven and sees a life, my friend, that he created, a life full of so much potential, get wasted and ruined because we won't surrender to God. Amen.
Amen.
But all the possibilities, all the potential, if we'd find God's will for our lives and purpose in our hearts to fulfill his purpose in our lives. Jeremiah 1:5, God said, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. God had a plan for Jeremiah. God's got a plan for every one of us. Amen. Do you know what that plan is? If I was you, I'd find my way to an altar and I'd say, Lord, I don't know what your will is for my life, but I want to find it, and I want to get in it. Because I'm telling you, there's joy in serving the Lord. Amen?
Number three, not only do we see a deliberate choice, but number three, I see another choice in the Bible, and this is a disgraceful choice. A disgraceful choice. Luke chapter number 15. There's a young man known as the prodigal son. This young man was raised in a good home. He's raised in a financially stable home. His father had great wealth and riches and servants. No doubt he was raised in a spiritually stable home. I have no doubt his father was a devout, God-fearing man. One reason I believe his father was a God-fearing man is because this young man left home and went to a foreign country to commit his wickedness. He knew his father would not stand for his foolishness and his wickedness. So he knew if he was going to live like he ended up living, and he knew if he was going to do the things that he ended up doing, he was going to have to leave home, and he was going to have to go to the foreign country to do it. And with that being said, I want to say thank God for godly mamas and daddies that are taking a firm stand on the word of God and say, you may live like the devil, but you're not going to do it and live in my house. Amen. Listen to me tonight, young men and young ladies. If you grew up in a godly home with a mama and a daddy that invested their lives in you to give you a Christian education, whether by homeschooling or Christian school, and they kept you faithfully involved in the house of God and in the work of God, and they're doing their best to raise you in the way that you should go, my friend, you've been sheltered by the grace of God. You've been kept in a safe place. You have no idea how much potential you have to be great for God. Amen. Your life is full of potential. Don't waste it by becoming a prodigal. I beg you tonight. As a matter of fact, the word prodigal by definition means waster. This young man is known as the prodigal son, but he's actually never called the prodigal son in the Bible. He got that title from verse number 13 where Jesus said he wasted his substance with riotous living. In spite of the fact that this boy was raised in a God-fearing home, he rebelled. This young man's life was full of godly potential, just like yours. But due to the choices he made, he went from being a son with potential to a son that was a prodigal. And I see young people all the time with rebellion in their heart. And you know what's in their heart because it's written all over their faces. And it's in their actions. Young people, rebellion is not a characteristic of a child of God. Amen. As a matter of fact, rebellion is such a serious matter that God said rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. And I see young people all the time who say they're saved by the grace of God, yet they absolutely despise and detest any shape or form of authority over them at all. My friend, rebellious is a serious thing, and rebellion is a dead-end street. My friend, you follow that blood of rebellion, you're going to end up on a dead-end road with a ruined life and a heart full of heartache. Amen. They'll start out by rebelling against their parents. They'll start rebelling against their pastor and Sunday school teacher. They'll start rebelling against the law. They'll start disrespecting police officers. Amen. Hey, listen to me, young people. There's a lot of young folks out there that disrespect law enforcement. You better distance yourself from those type of people. I tell you, anybody that has any issue, my friend, with the law, I guarantee you, they're up to no good. They're up to no good. Amen. Amen. And by rebelling against God-ordained authority in their life, they're ultimately rebelling against God. And unless God intervenes, they'll wind up in jail or ultimately in hell. Amen. That's where rebellion will take you. The reason young people rebel is they don't know what's good for them. Amen. Young person, you don't know as much as you think you know. Amen. The older I got, I realized I didn't know as much as I thought I knew. I found out mom and daddy knew a whole lot more than I thought they knew. Listen, that's why God gave you a mama and a daddy and a pastor and older people that love you to help guide you in the way that you should go, because you don't know everything like you think you do. And my friend, if you're not careful, you'll end up, my friend, under ungodly influence and be led away by the devil, and my friend, with a life full of hurt and pain. Amen.
Oh, listen, the devil knows how to paint a pretty picture. Amen. He knows how to make it look wonderful and splendid and harmless and enticing. But hear me well tonight, not everything that glitters is gold.
Amen.
The devil's a liar and the father of lies. Oh, hear me well tonight. The devil's got a pretty picture painted of alcohol. And man, it looks so fun. And everybody's doing it. But he won't show you the man that's a slave to alcohol. He won't show you a man that can't keep food on his table because of his bondage to drink. But he won't show you a mother laying over a casket of a child that's been killed by a drunk driver. He won't show you the end result of drunkenness. Amen. He's got a pretty picture painted about drugs. Amen. Come take a hit of this stuff. You've never lived until you've tried this stuff. My friend, you don't know what you're missing out on. It makes you feel so good. But he won't show you a man that's such a slave to drugs. He's stealing from his own mama just to get another fix. He won't show you the wasted life, the broken trust, the shattered dreams, the broken homes, and the prison bars that comes along with drugs. Amen. I've seen it.
Yes, sir.
Amen. God let our church operate a men's home for 6 years. And I was, of course, under our pastor, the overseer of the home. And I dealt with those men. No telling how many came through that men's home. I lost count a long time ago. No telling how many men, my friend, came through that men's home. And my friend, none of them started out with intentions of their life being wasted and ruined. None of them started out, my friend, with intentions of their life going down the tube. But my friend, it started out, hey, you got to try this. And hey, you got to try that. And my friend, before they knew it, their life's going down the tubes. Because of sin.
Amen.
Amen. Oh yes, the devil's got a pretty picture painted of gambling. Amen. Oh, look at the flashing lights and the casinos. Man, that looks like a lot of fun. But he won't show you a man that's lost everything he's got. Amen. The poker tables, a deck of cards, slot machines, and lottery tickets. He won't show you a man that can't pay his bills because he gambles his paycheck away week after week after week.
Amen.
Amen. Could tell you the times I've stood in line to pay for my gas. I've seen people drop $100 on lottery tickets, scratch them off and throw them in the trash. And my friend, the clothes they had on looked like they couldn't afford anything in this world. Drive an old beat up car, and I'm thinking, look at you. You're addicted to this sin of gambling, and you're throwing your money away week after week after week because that addiction's got a hold of their life. Listen to me, my friend. Sin will take you farther, my friend, than you ever dreamed that you'd ever go. It'll cost you more, my friend, that you'd ever dream you'd have to pay. And my friend, it'll keep you longer than you thought you'd ever have to stay.
Amen.
Sin's not what it's painted up to be. There's a high cost to low living. And there came a day when the pleasure of sin had passed in this prodigal's life. There came a day when he had spent all. There came a day when he had no more money. He had no more friends. You know, that's how the world would do you. You got money, you got friends. But as soon as the money dries up, the friends start to disappear as well. But there came a day when he had spent all and he began to be in want. And a mighty famine came in his life. All of a sudden, the party's over. He finds himself in a hog pen feeding hogs. He's a Jewish boy. Jews aren't even supposed to have any dealings with hogs, much less be raising them. But oh, how far down sin will take you. Now he's sitting in the hog pen feeding hogs. And it goes further than that. He's so hungry, he would fain or gladly have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. Sin's carried him to such a low level that he would gladly fill his own belly with the husk that the swine did eat. And you know what's so sad? No man gave unto him. So you better believe he's feeling some regret. Things have not turned out exactly the way he thought they would. And hear me well, young people. In this world, they never do. They never turn out like you think it will. Every young person, whoever goes out of the house of God to the far country, they're always going to be the exception. They're not going to end up like everybody else. They're going to have a good time. They're going to show everybody else how they can handle it.
never turns out like you think it will.
Amen.
And when he came to himself, a ton of regret came with it. Verse 17. And when he came to himself, he said, how many servants in my father's house had bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. That word perish, it means he's dying with hunger. There's an exclamation point at the end of verse number 17. The exclamation point sheds light on the emotion.